countries demanding a second investigation into COVID origin. The focus is firmly on Wuhan Institute of Virology, because there are many agencies, journalists and scientists who believe that coronavirus, which could have been man-made, leaked from the Wuhan lab. And two scientists who have researched extensively on this are Pune-based Dr. Monali Rahalkar and Dr. Rahul Bahulikar. Dr. Monali Rahalkar is a scientist in Bioenergy Group at Agarkar Research Institute of Pune, and Dr. Bahulikar is a scientist at BAIF Development and Research Foundation in Pune. Welcome Dr. Rahalkar and Dr. Bahulikar for joining us on Republic TV. Now, we have read your extensive research, and I have that with me right now. And there are some very interesting portions that we want you to share with Republic viewers, explain it to our viewers as well. So we would go point by point into how you worked to trace the origin and the course of COVID-19. So my first question to you would be, how did you start this research? What interested you in putting out this piece of research?
Okay. So it was a year ago. So it was exactly like April 2020 when the coronavirus pandemic had already struck India. Since we are scientists, we were researching all the papers. We were reading all the papers that how it could have been started. And it apparently happens that the Hunan market, the animal market, which was supposed to be the source of, the start of the COVID-19 pandemic, later on, they found out that it was not actually the place where it all started. So bat coronaviruses, bats were the source or the reservoirs of this virus. This was known, horseshoe bats. So we started reading more about Zenglishi, RATG-13 and so on. Just, I think I saw it in your program that your viewers are quite conversant with this RATG-13. And then it was like a, treasure hunt. Like we got clues after clues and we started researching this COVID-19 origins.
Yes, it's very interesting. Now, we were also informing our viewers of the Chinese scientist of the Wuhan Institute of Virology. Republic has been extensively covering it as well. And we believe that one of the turning points of your research was the discovery of lethal pneumonia-like disease that occurred in 6 miners in 2012. This is in connection with the Mojiang cave. Yes. So if you could tell our viewers more about that, can you explain to our viewers how the Mojiang discovery could be linked to COVID-19 outbreak?
Yes. So in 2012, this is a cave in Yunnan province. So Mojiang is the place. There was a copper mine. It was an abundant copper mine, and it was infested with various kinds of bats. There were 6 people who were employed to clean the bat fecal matter from that mine, and they worked there for 10 to 14 days, and they, one after the other, they got sick, and they were brought to a hospital in Kunming in Yunnan. Now these people had fever, cough, and they had breathing problems, and eventually they had to be shifted onto ventilators, and they had this ARDS, that is acute respiratory distress syndrome. And we found out the link between the Mojang mine shaft, the pneumonia cases, and the RATG-13, right, Rahul? Yes. And we documented it in a form of a preprint. Later on, we were contacted by a Twitter user who found a master thesis based on this particular cases. And we studied the master thesis. And maybe Rahul can tell you more about the master thesis, what was there in that.
Okay, in the master thesis, it was about how these people were, symptoms of those people, then how the corrective measures were taken by the scientists there. And the similarities between CT scans and all other things were given in that. And there was striking similarity between the today's COVID-19 symptoms and those symptoms.
Yes, so the symptoms were very similar, like the patients, the miners had cough, pneumonia. They also had some clotting problems in their blood. and their CT scans had ground glass opacities. Now, this ground glass opacities is a characteristic symptom in COVID-19. So you have this gray or white patch in your lung scans. So all these things actually indicated that this was a COVID-19 like disease. And second point, important point is that the Wuhan Institute of Virology led by Zheng Li Shi, she was employed or she was asked to collect coronavirus samples from this mine and bring them to the lab for study. So she did it for 3 years altogether. And they also studied the serum samples of these patients. So this was the important finding of our study.
Dr. Rahalkar and Dr. Bahulikar, you have made a very interesting point there talking about RATG-13, if I'm saying it correctly, who is believed to be the nearest cousin or the ancestor of SARS-CoV-2, of coronavirus. So would that mean that the origin of COVID could be traced back to as early as 2012, which is almost a decade from now? Decades before now.
Right. So RATG-13 is a 4% difference on the genomic level to SARS coronavirus 2. The people in WIB, they were sequencing this RATG-13. They finished sequencing in 2018 itself. So they had the sequence of RATG-13 in 2018. And perhaps, I mean, it is not the ancestor, but you know that they had certain techniques by which they could create chimeric viruses. They could also do serial passage, and which it some of these experiments could have, I mean, I'm saying could have led to the formation of SARS-CoV-2 starting from RATG-13. Or maybe like what Rahul also suggested, they could have another close relative of COVID-2 from that mine shaft, right?
So your research also highlights the role of Shi Zhengli, who is the deputy director and principal investigator of the Wuhan Institute of Virology, and there has been a lot of talk about her. She's also known as the Batwoman. Now, if you could also elaborate on your findings and how have you researched through, how have you established through your research that Shi Zhengli could be one of the primary characters in this entire lab leak theory?
So when you look at the Wuhan, now WIV or Wuhan Institute of Virology, it has the largest collection of coronaviruses, and it is all because of this Batwoman or Zheng Li Shi, who collaborated with Dr. Peter Daszak from the United States. So we have to start from SARS-1. So after SARS-1 was there in China, Chinese scientists wanted to find out that how did SARS-1 begin? And so Zheng Li Shi was looking at caves after caves, and she was trying to find out the progenitors or the, you know, ancestors of SARS-1. That's how they collected so many viruses. And when they went to this Mojang mine, they found that a very different or a unique virus like RATG-13, and there were human cases associated with this virus. So Zheng Li Shi brought total 9, right? 9 SARS-like coronaviruses from this particular mine shaft. I mean, the samples were brought, and she did not disclose all of her research in the form of research papers. Like, I think after the pandemic, after like 11 months of the pandemic, now she later on disclosed that they did a survey for 3 years. Also, in our research, we found out that Zheng Li Shi and her group were responsible for doing the antibody test of this miners, the SARS antibody test. And it was positive according to one PhD thesis. But Zheng Li Shi denied this in her November 2020 published addendum. And she admitted that they had brought SARS-like coronaviruses. But the sequences were missing. They did not immediately disclose the sequence. So all in the, I mean, in all these, all of these different points, we come to Zheng Li Shi, the Batwoman, who was quite instrumental in all this research, right?
Yes, very, very explosive findings there you have. And in fact, in your research, you've also mentioned that Mysteriously, several databases of Wuhan Institute of Virology, which were online, are now offline. Now, you claim that there are 22,000 coronavirus samples were included in this database who have very mysteriously gone offline now. So, can you explain what that could mean? Does it look like a part of a cover-up on part of the Wuhan Institute of Virology as well?
It could be cover-up because in September 2019 only, they have their offline, made up offline these samples. And that might have some clue about this recent infection, because one of the sequences might be very close to this one, and that's why China wanted to hire him. That's the one possibility.
Yes, so these so you're saying that these databases were offline as early as September 2019, which was just few months ahead of the outbreak in Wuhan. Is that correct?
And we do not know. Sorry, Sanika, we do not know exactly when the outbreak started, because we know that it might have started in November, according to the Chinese news, but there are some predictions that it could have been started little earlier, like September or so. So that actually coincides with the removing of the databases, right? So, I mean, that's the point.
That is
Yes, and in fact, there are a lot of reports also, because we know last week there were some international media reports that said that there were some mysterious illness in the Wuhan Institute of Virology in November as well, where they sought hospitalization. So probably all of this is falling in place.
Yes.
Now, you also mentioned that you had sent your paper to top journals, top scientific journals. But they did not find these cases important and did not review the paper.
Yes.
Now, is it because till last month, Wuhan lab leak was just seen as a conspiracy theory, and now the Wuhan lab leak theory is gaining ground only because US is also stepping in and has ordered an investigation?
Yes. We face several difficulties in publishing our paper, not difficulties, but we send it to journals like Science or NEJM, the New England Journal of Medicine, because we thought that this was all medical data, right? So it should go into some medical journal, and it was of prime importance. But they said that it is not of importance in order to, even review the paper. They did not even review the paper. But now what the paper you are showing was published in Frontiers in Public Health, which is a very good journal, and it has more than 51,000 views, and it is also cited as one of the main references. Also, in the US, Senate had prepared a letter for EcoHealth Alliance, so it was mentioned in that. And the cases, because all the information about these cases was hidden in a master thesis, and also the master thesis was comparison of this thesis with COVID-19 was very important, and that's what we have done in our paper. We have verified all the medical data, and we have verified the CT scans and the x-rays in the medical thesis by showing it to a radiologist, and he also verified that this looks very much like COVID-19.
Yes, and exactly, we have your research paper on our screens as well, the one that was published. Now, we know, Dr. Rahalkar and Dr. Bahulikar, that we have been seeing a lot of talk about gain-of-function research, and now we have seen how highly developed nations like the United States of America are funding it. Now, do you think, following this pandemic, the scientific community in India and even the world need to rethink and set norms about such kind of research? If you could elaborate on that and your opinion on that.
Yeah, I think Rahul should. He wants me to speak. Okay.
Go ahead.
So gain of function research was banned in USA in 2014 during the Obama government, but again in 2017 they lifted the ban. So as such, what is gain of function? So gain of function is making viruses or even other pathogens more pathogenic, so that they could infect more or get transmitted more easily. And I think this is quite a dangerous thing to do, because let's take an example of this coronaviruses. Now, for example, Zengli, she brings some coronavirus samples from a cave, and if she improves the characters or makes the receptor binding domain more easy to bind to the human ACE2 receptors, then it will become very much more infectious. So such experiments, I don't know whether there was a ban in China or not, but in the USA also the ban was lifted. So such kind of experiments, either gain of function or little bit closer to those, they might be going on all over the world, and that could be very dangerous because it's also the safety level issue, right?
Yeah.
Because
the safety level, the use for these experiments was two level, and normally four is required. So in this case, if in any case the you have virus with human infecting ability and it is released by somehow or by infecting the people who are working with it, that's dangerous, and that might be one of the reasons of this lab leak.
Yeah. So safety level is also very important, and GOF bans should also be there, I think.
So do you, as part of your research, do you think that the pandemic, the outbreak from the Wuhan Institute, from Wuhan in fact, and could have certain links to the gain of function research from the US to Wuhan Institute of Virology?
There are no proofs. We don't have tech proofs, but there is a possibility.
And also the USA, Dr. Peter Daszak was working with Zengli Shi in a collaborative research for several years. They were doing kind of gain of research. For example, they were testing different viruses of different backbones with and spike of a different virus. So, and they were testing this in humanized mice. So humanized mice are mice which express the human ACE2 receptors. And for example, if a virus is present in such a humanized mice, and it gets leaked, it is already adapted to the human receptors, right? Or there were also ferrets or other small or larger animals which they were working with. So any accident happening from the lab, or any accident happening because of the escape of the animal, or the waste of the animal, can also lead to such escape of a pathogen. So, so US GOF research is indirectly related, but again, now it's a controversy whether it was GOF or not. So,
So that definitely would be a matter of investigation. And while we are talking about gain of function, there are also reports of how Dr. Fauci has been saying that I would like to see the medical records of the three people who are reported to have got sick in 2019. Now, he's referring to the Wuhan lab workers who were hospitalized in November. Yeah. Now, given your research, do you think that that India should also come up with such a demand and make China accountable for what has happened in Wuhan preceding to the outbreak as the world knows it?
I think India has shown support to United States. I think it was a statement last Friday or so that India would also support the investigation of a lab leak. I mean, they would support, I think, United States in this particular mission. But yes, we feel that this matter should be investigated till the end. And also, as we are a group of scientists, so 26 scientists we wrote three different letters to WHO. And we also listed the shortcomings of their report. They had focused very less on the lab leak theory, and we insisted that the lab leak or the lab origin at least should be investigated in more details, because this could be a prime reason, why the virus came out, because they were working with very similar stuff. So, I mean, this should be researched, because it's a question of 3.5 million people who have died from this. Yes. We strongly believe that this should be investigated.
Yes. Dr. Ahalkar and Dr. Bahulikar, we are getting massive response to this interview, the live interview that we are conducting right now. And some viewers also have some questions and what we are getting, the live feedback that we are getting, is that there are claims that the RAT G13 and SARS-CoV-2 are 96% similar. Now, RAT G13 is believed to be the ancestor of SARS-CoV-2. Now, these two viruses are 96% similar. And some people say that 96% similarity is not similar enough. But do you think with gain of function research, can that gap be bridged? Yes. Or what do you have to say about these allegations that are being made?
So there are two, three different things. Like RATG13 is the virus which they have disclosed, the genome which they have disclosed. There could be some unknown viruses of which the sequences they have not disclosed, and they are still present in their databases. Point number two is, suppose if you have a particular sequence of a virus, there are methods to synthetically make a virus from a type sequence also. So it is possible. Now we do not know whether WIV or any other labs in China have done it, but theoretically it is possible. Like there are two reports from US and the Switzerland that after COVID-19, they could make the whole SARS-CoV-2 synthetically. So synthetic derived virus is a second option, or you can call artificial virus. Third option could be
passaging through various cell lines. So that can also
lead to
such virus and
serial passaging.
That is also one of the
possibilities.
So talking about synthetic viruses, and we were also talking about Shi Zhengli. Now, as per what Shi Zhengli has, the interviews that she's given, and as per your research, now she says that she took a very little time to clear her own doubts, in fact, that the virus could have leaked from her lab. She claims it took only hours. Now, is it possible for her to give a clean chit so soon?
No, I think because WHO team also spent, I think, like 3 hours there, and they just looked at the presentation, and they just took Dr. Peter Daszak, his word as the final, you know, that he told that there is no virus closer to RATG13. And so they didn't even copy the database of WIV, which was taken offline. They could have at least taken the 61 million MB database with them.
Their lab books are also important.
Yeah, the lab books, lab records, I don't think they could have seen in such a short time. Yeah. Also, they did not have the mandate to do this. So all this has to be done in an investigative or intelligence-based manner. Their lab books should be checked, and also there should be more emphasis on the type of projects they were running. And also, even they are saying that the military role is also very significant in WIV, which Zhengli she has denied on record that they did not have any such military role in the institute. But however, she has said this, so there is nothing to verify, because she has also said many different things which later on then she changed those. So
Yes, and there are many reports that we know of, we've read of SARS-CoV-2 being a bioweapon, in fact. Exactly, we've seen multiple papers, many researchers talking about it. So when you have so much material, research material, what do you think should be the way forward to ensure that the world gets to know the truth of coronavirus, and so that the world doesn't have to see another pandemic like what we're witnessing right now?
Yes, I think, there should be a coordinated efforts from all the countries to push China to give us the truth. And also, if they are not going to tell us, then they should support an investigation, which all the countries should, they should emphasis on it.
And also, they should stop the gain of function research on virus, specifically in viruses.
Yes.
Because that may
lead
to worse.
And also, they have another passion of collecting this coronaviruses from bat caves, which has led to a collection of numerous samples, like 22,000 samples they have. And maybe they would be collecting more, because recently I heard from Zhengli that this is just the tip of iceberg, and they want to collect more samples. And I think this is very dangerous, because these horseshoe bats are tiny animals, and they are just living in their bat caves. So if you purposefully go there and disturb them, and then collect their bat feces and bring all these viruses in a crowded city like Wuhan, which has 11 million population, it is very dangerous, because maybe next time directly you get a SARS-CoV-3 virus in a particular sample and it gets leaked in the sewage, or you know, it directly infects someone in a low security lab. What are you going to do about that, right?
Yes, Dr. Ahalkar and Dr. Bahulikar, it was very enlightening talking to you, because there were many questions that many people had as far as COVID-19 or SARS-CoV-2 is concerned, and your research has actually helped streamline a lot of answers. This could be the first step, and we're hoping for a bigger investigation, a bigger global investigation, so that we definitively know what the truth is behind the pandemic. Thank you very much for joining us on Republic TV and sharing with us your research.
Thank you, Sanika. We thank you and all the viewers. Thank you so much.
Thank you.